ihren Wein. Und die Gläser sollen dazu klingen, denn es muss geschieden sein. Gib mir deine Hand, deine weiße Hand. Leb wohl, mein Schatz, leb wohl, mein Schatz, leb wohl.
Hello and welcome on board of the German sailing ship SMS Seeadler. My name is Nick and today I want to show you the ship and tell you the story of one of the last fighting sailing ships to be used in war when she served as a merchant raider with Imperial Germany in World War I. SMS is the German abbreviation for His Majesty's Ship and Seeadler means Sea Eagle in German. Seeadler was a commerce raider of the German Imperial Navy during World War I and had a successful raiding career, capturing and sinking 15 ships in 225 days until she was wrecked, in 2 August 1917, in French Polynesia. But how does it all begin? The Seeadler was not always a German ship. Originally, the ship was launched as Pass of Balmaha by Robert Duncan Company in Port Glasgow, Scotland, on the August 9th of 1888 as a steel-hulled ship-rigged sailing vessel measuring 1,571 gross register tons. She was 245 feet long, 39 feet in beam and with a depth of 23 feet. In February 1908, Pass of Balmaha was sold at Leith by Gibson Clark to the River Plate Shipping Company Ltd. of Montreal. Her port of registry remained Glasgow, but she was managed by American interests in Boston, Massachusetts. Soon after the outbreak of World War I in 1914, Pass of Balmaha was transferred to the neutral United States flag and registered at Boston in the ownership of the Harvey Steamship Company Ltd. of New York, part of the Harris Irby Cotton Company. An exciting story is how the ship became German. Pass of Balmaha departed from New York Harbor in June 1915, bound for the Arctic port of Arkhangelsk with a cargo of cotton for Russia. She was intercepted by the British auxiliary cruiser Victorian off the coast of Norway. Victorian's captain led a boarding party to inspect the cargo for contraband. The British captain found reason for suspicion and ordered Pass of Balmaha to sail to Kirkwall in the Orkney Islands for further inspection. A prize crew of an officer and six Marines was left aboard to ensure compliance. The British also ordered the neutral American colors struck and replaced with the British flag. Against the will of Pass of Balmaha's Captain Scott, who realized that this would mark the ship as a belligerent. A German submarine, U-36, spotted and intercepted Pass of Balmaha and its commander Ernst Graf entered the ship with a boarding party for inspection. Graf was not entirely convinced by this ruse and ordered Pass of Balmaha to sail for the German harbor Cuxhaven for inspection. Since U-36 was short of personnel, the German prize crew consisted of only one man. A German ensign was left aboard. Scott and his crew, resentful of what they perceived as British meddling, kept the British Marines locked in the hold. Pass of Balmaha reached Cuxhaven without major incident and was boarded by a German inspection party. Captain Scott then revealed the British prize crew to the Germans, who took them prisoner. For their cooperation, the Americans were allowed free passage to a neutral country, but Pass of Balmaha became property of the German Navy. Please go down the stairs and proceed to the middle deck. By 1916, the Allies had blockaded German warships in the North Sea, and Germany converted a considerable number of merchant ships into merchant raiders by equipping them with guns and sending them in search of Allied merchant shipping. Most of the armed raiders were not particularly successful, but they did tie up considerable Allied forces in hunting them. The problem was that any commerce raiders that succeeded in breaking out lacked foreign or colonial bases for resupply of coal. This gave rise to the idea of equipping a sailing ship instead, since it would not require coaling. Seeadler was completely overhauled at Johan Tekelenborg shipyard and equipped with an auxiliary engine, hidden lounges, accommodation for additional crew and prisoners, two 105mm guns which you can see behind me, two hidden heavy machine guns, and rifles for boarding parties. However, these weapons were rarely fired. Standing here next to Captain Lieutenant Felix von Luckner. As an officer with extensive experience of large sailing ships, he was appointed to command Seeadler at the end of 1916. Good morning, Captain.
Guten Morgen.
Please proceed now to the foredeck. Seeadler began its raiding turn on December 21, 1916 when she left port and managed to slip through the British blockade disguised as a Norwegian wood carrier. Many of the crew of 6 officers and 57 men, including Luckner himself, had been selected for their ability to speak Norwegian in case they were intercepted by the British. By Christmas Day, Seeadler was southeast of Iceland, where she encountered the British armed merchant cruiser, Avenger. Avenger put an inspection party aboard. Only the Norwegian-speaking sailors stood on board wearing civil clothes. The rest of the sailors sit below deck ready to use their arms. But the British inspection party failed to detect the German deception and gave Seeadler free passage. On January 9, 1917, Seeadler came upon a British single-funneled steamer, raised a signal requesting a time signal, not an uncommon thing for a sailing ship long out of contact with land to do, and raised the German ensign too late for the target ship to take any evasive action. 3 shots were needed to persuade the 3,268-ton Gladys Royal, carrying coal from Cardiff to Buenos Aires, to heave to. Her crew was taken off unharmed, and she was scuttled. The following day, Seeadler encountered another British steamship, which refused to identify itself. The German ensign was raised and a shot fired across the bow of the Lundy Island, which was carrying sugar from Madagascar. The steamer still refused to heave to, and Luckner fired 4 rounds directly at her. The steamer then hove to and lowered her boats, but her captain ignored an order to come to Seeadler. A German boarding party was sent over and discovered that the crew had abandoned ship when the first shots were fired, leaving the captain alone on board. Captain Bannister later told Luckner that he had previously been captured by a German raider and had given his parole, which he had broken. Thus, he was not anxious to be a prisoner of war again. Luckner continued his voyage southwards, and by January 21 he was in mid-Atlantic between Brazil and West Africa when he found the 2,199-ton French 3-masted bark Charles Gounod, which was loaded with corn. She was quickly dispatched, but her logbook recorded information about other ships she had met and their intended route. We will now proceed with the tour. Please go downstairs and follow me. I will show you more of the ship. The period between January and mid of March was a lucky time for Luckner when he spotted one ship after another in same area. On January 24th, the small 364-ton Canadian schooner First was met and sunk by machine gun fire after taking off her crew and her captain's new bride. The 3,071-ton French four-master Antoinette, which was loaded with Chilean salpetre, was overhauled on February 3rd and soon scuttled. On February 9th, the 1,811-ton Italian Buenos Aires, also carrying salpetre, was sunk. On February 19, a four-masted bark was spotted, which immediately piled on sail in an effort to get away. However, Seeadler's engines allowed her to overhaul the 2,431-ton British four-master Pinmore, which was carrying a cargo of grain. By coincidence, Luckner had himself sailed in Pinmore in his civilian sailing days, back in 1902. He took Pinmore into Rio de Janeiro in order to get more supplies, before eventually scuttling her. The next ship to be stopped was the Danish bark Viking, but as there was nothing unusual about her cargo, the neutral ship was allowed to proceed unmolested. On the morning of February 26, 1917, the 1,953-ton Canadian bark British Yeoman, carrying a welcome cargo including chickens and pigs, was stopped and sunk. The same evening the French four-master La Rochefoucauld fell victim to the Seeadler. The boarding party discovered La Rochefoucauld had only recently been stopped by a British cruiser which was looking for Seeadler. On the evening of March 5, Seeadler discovered a four-masted bark in the moonlight and signaled, "Stop immediately, German cruiser." Bizarrely, the captain of the 2,206-ton French ship Duplex rowed across to Seeadler, convinced another French captain was playing a practical joke on him. He was soon disabused of the idea when his ship was scuttled. Seeadler's next victim on March 10th was asked for the time, but ignored the signal. Luckner ordered a smoke generator to be lit, and the 3,609-ton Horn Guard turned back to render assistance to the burning sailing ship. A single shot put the British ship's radio out of action. This resulted in the only loss of life in the Seeadler's voyage. A British young sailor, Douglas Page, was killed when a steam pipe was ruptured by the shot. He received a formal burial at sea. Horngarth was soon scuttled by Seeadler's crew. By this time, Luckner had the problem of feeding and keeping safe nearly 300 prisoners, in addition to his own crew. Consequently, when on March 20th, the French four-masted bark Cambronne was captured, Luckner arranged for the ship's topgallant mast and additional spars and sails to be removed, before putting his prisoners aboard Cambronne under the command of Captain Mullen of Pinmore. Luckner ordered to reduce rigging on Cambronne, ensuring Seeadler would be able to escape before her location could be reported to the hunting ships. The Royal Navy was well aware of Seeadler's general location and set a trap consisting of the armed merchant cruisers Otranto and Orbita and the armored cruiser HMS Lancaster at Cape Horn. However, a severe storm blew Seeadler considerably further south before she entered the Pacific Ocean on April 18th and sailed north along the Chilean coast. By early June, Seeadler was east of Christmas Island and learned that the United States had entered the war. Seeadler therefore turned her attention to American shipping, sinking the 529-ton A.B. Johnson of San Francisco on June 14, the 673-ton I.C. Slade the next day, and the schooner Manila on July 8. We have now nearly finished our tour on Seeadler and you have learned a lot about the raiding crews of the ship. Please go upstairs to the quarterdeck and wait at our starting point. There I will finally tell you how Seeadler ended her successful career. After the long trip, Luckner decided that Seeadler has to be laid up so that her hull could be scraped clean. She put into the small island of Mapelia, also known as Mapia, a coral atoll some 10 kilometers in diameter in the Society Islands, some 450 kilometers from Tahiti. Seeadler was too large to enter the sheltered lagoon of Mapelia, and consequently had to anchor outside the reef. On August 2, disaster struck. According to Luckner, the ship was struck by a tsunami which wrecked her on the reef. However, some American prisoners alleged that the ship drifted aground while the prisoners and most of the crew were having a picnic on the island. The crew and their 46 prisoners were now stranded on Mapelia. But they managed to salvage provisions, firearms, and two of the ship's boats. No prisoners or crew were killed. The ship was burned in an attempt to hide their presence from Allied ships. This was the official end of Seeadler, but not for Luckner and his crew. With his crew and prisoners safely ashore and the ship stripped of valuables and equipment, von Luckner decided to take the navigator and four crewmen in one of the ship's boats in an attempt to capture another ship, in which to return to Germany. The party eventually reached one of the Fijian islands but were captured and taken to New Zealand as prisoners of war. Despite a well-planned, but unsuccessful escape attempt, they remained prisoners of war until 1919. The remainder of the crew captured a Chilean schooner which called at the island in September and made Easter Island, where they were interned and taken to the mainland. I have now come to the end of my story and I hope you enjoyed the tour. Goodbye.